It's moving. So today we will primarily talk about what is data, how to handle data, and some basic statistical concepts which are required if you are working into data analytics field. And they become more important in predictive risk analytics, because when you work into predictive risk analytics, it's not just about taking the data and making models out of it. You need to understand the data first. You need to know what each variable is talking about. You need to know the final model which you will be making. What are the different variables you should be taking into that? How those individual variables are responding? What are their traits? What is their distribution? So those kind of things are very important to understand before trying to build a model. So we'll start with a very basic concept. What is data? So in terms of analytics, or in context of financial analytics, whatever data you will be facing in your day-to-day life while you're working in your office, while you get the data from your clients, it would be a combination of variables. So what are variables? So different data fields which are there in the data are called variables in the analytics or statistical term. And they actually contain values. And the values can be numeric or categorical in nature. When you say the data is numerical, the values you will see, those will be in numbers. They would be in numeric form, like 100, 200, 9 billion, 9 million, something like that. And when you talk about categorical variables, they would take in the form of categories. There would be some kind of names of labels, like if you have a variable called sex. So the different values would be M or F, male or female. When you talk about regions or directions, they could be four, like north, east, south, west. So these variables are called categorical. Now, as a data analyst, your job is to derive meaningful conclusions out of the data. So data in its crude form is not useful. It's like an input or raw material to the factory. If you don't produce any meaningful output out of it, the final consumers will not get benefited. And in data analytics perspective, the final consumers are the business people and senior leadership. When you talk about data analytics, it involves extraction of trends, patterns, and ultimately the useful information from the data which you have. Some people also call it as business intelligence, and this intelligence helps a business to make more profit and make better use of their resources. Also, the operations of the company also improve by doing analytics. Now, if you look at the third point, if you talk about a company or a financial company or a bank, a data helps in making decision-making insight into the following key areas. So with the use of data, you can predict customer trends and behaviors. You can analyze, interpret, and deliver data in meaningful ways. That is the key requirement from senior management, to make meaningful conclusions out of the data. Analytics helps you to increase business productivity and thus helps in driving effective decision making. So this was a very brief introduction to the data to make you understand what is the data all about. Now going a bit deeper, when you talk about data in analytics perspective or predictive perspective, there are two types of variables which you will face. One would be numerical variables and second would be categorical. Numerical variables can be divided into two types. So one is discrete. So discrete variables arise from counting, like I'm counting the number of attendees in this session. Also, they can take any particular negative or fractional values as well. So if you see a number line and you take only the whole numbers, that is an example of discrete data. Your number line starts from minus infinity and goes up till positive infinity. You just take the whole numbers and there you go. That is the example of discrete numerical variables. When you talk about credit risk analytics, the particular examples of such type of data is a credit score of a person, a FICO score or a CIBIL score which a person gets. If a person gets a FICO score of 650, 670, 770, that is a type of discrete data. The number of credit cards owned by a person. There were some, I think Bryn Mawr or someone, they are holding 3 credit cards right now. I know they are rich, but that is an example of discrete numerical variable. Another example is continuous numerical variables. Now they arise from measuring. So if you look at a measuring tape or a measuring scale, you see the numbers are continuous in nature. So they are not just whole numbers like 1, 2, 3. They have pointers or a scale. They are in between, there are pointers as well, like 1.1, 1.2. And if you further divide it, I believe a lot of you would have been familiar with the concept of differentiation. So any continuous variable can take any value between minus infinity to to positive infinity. That could be in decimals as well. For example, height of the person. A person can have a height of 5.1, 5.11, 5.12, 5.13, and so on and so forth. The amount of money do you have, your age in days or in hours or in seconds or in milliseconds. That is an example of continuous variable. The second type is categorical variables. Categorical variables can be further divided into 3 types. First is binary or dichotomous. As you know, dichotomous contains the word di, and di means 2. And binary is always 2. So when you talk about binary categorical variables, they have only 2 categories. For example, for an answer, you have y or n, yes or no populated. For sex, you have male or female populated. For result, you have pass or fail populated. In terms of nominal variables, so they are categorical variables again, they are not numeric in nature, and they have several unordered categories. Okay. So, for example, you have a type of bank account. So yesterday, if you remember, we studied there are savings account, checking account, and any kind of FD. Take it as a FD account. So these are 3 types of accounts which we are talking right now. But any ordering is not important here, right? So you can either talk savings account first or you can talk checking account first. There is no difference. Or type of insurance policy. You have auto policy, you have medical policy, you have life insurance policy. So these are different categories which you have under the type of insurance policy, but ordering does not matter here. And another last example is ordinal categorical variable. Now here, under the category, the ordering is very important. For example, if you talk about the distribution of marks within a class and divide it into ranges of low, medium and high. So here, low has a role to play, medium has a role to play and high has a role to play. So ordering has a role to play here. When you go online sometimes, like you eat outside or you buy something or you receive a courier from internet company where they are delivering goods to you like Amazon or Flipkart, They ask you about your feedback. They ask you to rate it from the scale of 1 to 10. And 1 would be like strongly against, 10 would be like strongly in favor. So their ordering is important. You cannot just place 1, 2 and then start with 8 or 9, then again start with 5 or 6. So ordering is important there. Okay. Here we have simply again described those variable types, numerical and categorical, into different areas. So any questions on these categories till now, or sorry, on the types of data till now? Okay, great. Now I will give you a very brief example of a data which you will see while you are preparing a credit risk model. So this is I will tell you how to identify the different variables, and in the rows below the value stored, variable type and remarks. So variable type and remarks are for you to understand, and value stored would be the actual values which would be stored under the individual variables or data variables or data labelings. So you can call these as headers, data variables, data headings, variable names, but usually in the industry they are called as variables. So if you start with initial one, the name of the customer. So the name of the customer usually would be hidden, would be simply the name, right? Like you have Mrinmoy, you have Satish, all those people, the name would be in front of them. Then you have customer ID. So these are identification variables. Okay. So for example, if you talk about a customer ID for a bank, a customer ID can be 2, 3, 4 or whatever customer ID a bank gives. So that is a unique identifier for a particular customer. Now, if you want to check against that customer, how many credit cards they are holding. So for example, if against an individual A who has a customer ID 1, you are populating the number of credit cards equal to 1. And against the customer with the name B, unique identifier 2, the number of credit cards could be 2, and so on and so forth. Now, this number of credit cards is a numerical variable. Numerical variable and is a discrete one. It does not take decimal values or fractional values. It takes discrete 1, 2, or 3 values or natural numbers or whole numbers. Then you have age of the customer on last birthday in terms of years. What is the age of that particular individual customer? When we talk about the customer A, it's his age or her age could be 18, 19 or 20 or any of the value. Again, that is a numerical. If you talk about the gender of the customer, it becomes a binary or categorical variable. So the value you can pass is either male or female. Now we talk about the marital status. The customer is married and divorced can be represented by D, never married can be represented in data by NM, or you can represent it by the complete word as well. So these are again categorical variables, but they are nominal. So I'll go back. What is a nominal? It is a several unordered category. So it is a category where ordering does not matter. You just have to define different categories. Let's come to the last variable, monthly credit card usage. If you divide the usage into a percentage, like the credit limit of a customer has got, how much percentage they have used, and you have divided into four bands. First band is lower than 25%, then medium 25 to 50%, then high 50 to 75%, then very high 75% plus. So these are four categories and where order is important. So these variables are ordinal. And the last one is annual salary, which is the amount variable. It's a numerical variable and a continuous. When you actually look into your bank account, any amount can come, like 100.12, 100.13, 200, 200.02. So that is a continuous variable. It can take any value from minus infinity to positive infinity on a number line. Okay. So any questions on this? Any example which you did not understand? Because guys, this is very basic, but this is very important when you are actually building the model. If you don't understand the data, if you're not able to understand what are the different variables, what they are talking about, what are their categories, you will not be able to understand how you will be taking into your model. So numerical variables are taken into a model in a different way. Categorical variables are treated in a different way. So there is no response, so I believe it's all clear. Okay, great. Thanks, Asif. Thanks, Minmay, for answering. And so I can see the answer of Asif and Minmay. What about Rahul, Roop, and Santosh? Are you guys following me? Are you with me? Okay, Roop says yes. What about Rahul? Santosh is also clear. What about Rahul? Rahul, are you following?
Hello?
Yes, Vishal?
Yeah, Tarun, I am writing something, but it's not popping up in the chat box.
Okay.
Whenever I write something, it's not visible here. So I don't know what's the problem. But I can see the screen. Everything is fine.
Okay, but I can see your chat. You wrote, yeah, I just saw it. You wrote clear as well.
Yeah, but I can't see my comment here in the chat box.
I'm not sure about it because other people are able to see it. Maybe you can try to
see. I can type, I can see that, but when I hit enter, it's not visible to me.
That's
maybe you can see the.
I'm able to see the chat, so that's okay.
Okay, fine, fine then.
Okay. Sorry, I missed your question, Asif. Credit ratings are an example of. Yes, you can say that. Okay. Now, whenever you're working as an analyst and you get the data for any analytical purpose, so you don't just start building a model. First, you study that data. You try to understand what are the different variables, how their distribution look like, what is the information those variables are giving to you, and what actually you can derive from those variables while making a model. So it becomes very important to summarize the data at a first level and show it to your business leaders or partners or clients. Because a lot of times when you're making a model, a particular variable may make a statistical sense, but from a business perspective, that variable may not make sense as much. And a lot of times, guys, out of experience, I'm telling you, it happens that as an analyst, you're pretty sure that you want to include this variable, a particular variable X or Y. But when you actually go to the senior management, because of their experience and because of what they want to show to the senior leadership, they may or may not want to include that variable. So that kind of tweakings are required while you are making the model to make a model define business more properly and also to justify senior leadership objectives. So from that perspective, summarizing the data and checking the data variables is very important. Now, when you're studying the different variables and you try to summarize it, there are few methods or ways through which you can summarize the data. So whether you are making a model, then also it's important, even if you're not making a model, if you're doing any kind of analysis, a simple analysis of the data, if you summarize it well, you will get a more hold of data. And when you go into the business meeting, the different questions which come to you, you will have preparation beforehand, and you will be able to answer a lot of questions, and you will gain much more insights into the data, which you can provide to your senior leaders. So the different examples are frequency distribution, group, cumulative, stemly, blind plot, and we will be covering them in the following slides. So first is a simple frequency distribution. So what is the frequency? Frequency contains word frequent, which comes from English word frequent. So you just check how frequent a particular value shows into the data. Okay, so it is a technique to summarize the discrete data. So any discrete number you summarize using a frequency. Yes, Mrinmoy, I'm using my slides. Are you not able to see my screen? Okay, I'm restarting then. Okay. I have disconnected screen sharing and started it again. So are you guys able to see my screen? I'm on slide 9. Okay, great. I'm moving back to slide 8. Are you guys able to see the moment? Okay, great. So we were on slide 9. This is the slide 8 which I quickly covered. It just tells you the different ways to summarize the data. And now we will start with the first method, which is frequency distribution. So as I said, frequency distribution is how frequently a value particularly appears in your data. And when I talk about data, it's more about a discrete data. So for example, if you see on the below left table, so if your manager or senior leadership gives you a data and they ask you, hey, Mrinmoy, I have a data of around 25 million customers. Okay. And minimum credit cards my customer hold is 1. Minimum number of credit card is 1. And the maximum a customer can hold is 10. So give me the distribution for that. So what Mrinmoy will do is he will go into the data. He will check the frequency distribution. He will check that against individual number of credit card, how many customers are there. So how many customers are holding number of credit card with number equal to 1, how many are holding 2 cards, how many are holding 3, and so on and so forth. He will make a distribution something like this. And sometimes it can happen that when your business leader says, hey, I know my data contains a customer has a maximum of 10 cards. But when you're actually going to the data, that number might vary. You might see some customers holding 12 cards, or you might not see any customer holding more than 8 cards. So these kind of small findings which you will be telling to your business leader. So now in terms of frequency distribution, you will simply plot it on the graph on the right side. On x-axis below, you have number of cards, which is 1 to 10. It is a discrete number, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. And then you have number of customers on your y-axis. So as you see in the table on the left side, so where the number of credit cards sold by individual person is sold, that is the maximum amount of customers. So if you see in your chart where x equal to 4, your y, which is number of customers, is 660. So that is the maximum. So that is a very basic finding you can get from your data, that most, that say if I have 2000 customers in total, you say that out of that 2000, around 600 customers have credit cards more than 4 or equal to 4. So you can say more than 25% of the customers are having a credit card count of 4. And if you want to do any analysis or you want to build any strategy, you might consider the bars from 2 to 6, say for example. So you might say, hey, if I consider the customers which are holding number of cards from 2 to 6, that takes around 80% of my population or 75% of my population. So I want to do analysis only on that particular population, and that will be applicable to my business rules or business judgments in the future. And you can say the number of customers who are holding cards 9 or 10, they are very less. So I may not be able to, you know, it's not statistically sound to include such kind of people where frequency is very low into my analysis. So you can base your analysis or strategy into the area where maximum chunk of your population lies. So here you see a simple example how you can summarize the data using frequency distribution in MS Excel. There are advanced filter options in Excel, otherwise there are shortcuts as well. So if you look at the third one, so this is the number of credit cards. Into the four table, you sort it out and you check the frequency of customers against the person who are holding credit cards 1 to 10. And then you make a similar histogram out of it. So here we have used a bar chart. You can use a line plot as well. Depends on how you want to present your data and what the senior management actually wants. Next is a higher version of the frequency distribution which we talked about. It's called grouped frequency distribution. Okay. So Rahul has left, okay. Okay, so let's talk about group frequency distribution. Guys, on this session, if you think that I need to cover it very quickly because you guys are all familiar, or you find my pace fine as per your requirement, do let me know whether the pace is fine or I need to increase or decrease it. Rahul has arrived back. So, okay. So do let me know if you find my pace. Yeah, okay. Okay, Brinmar. Thanks. Okay. So it's a higher version of frequency distribution, which we were talking in our previous slide. It's called group frequency distribution. So here, so in my previous slide, we summarized a discrete data. Here is a way to summarize a continuous data or a discrete data which is having a very large number of observations and have a wider range. Okay, so what we do simply here is we divide the data into different ranges or intervals, and then we check that banding or the range for the number of customers. So for example, if you go in this graph. Right now you are dividing into discrete category from 1 to 10. Yes. Yeah, it's a yes, Asif, it's again a histogram. It's just that on x-axis you are making ranges of data rather than passing discrete values. So here also you can make it a group frequency distribution by just making two graphs. Like you can make number of customers holding cards 1 to 5 and 6 to 10. Then you will be just getting two bars here. Similar thing you are doing in this. So because salaries range to the range of salary is quite huge, so you divide it into different intervals and then check the number of customers against each. Another example of the frequency distribution is cumulative frequency distribution. So this is also used while you will be building the models and finally checking some of the statistics. This cumulative method will be helpful. And I hope cumulative, all of you are aware about cumulative. So basically cumulative frequencies are obtained when you add up the frequency of the previous observation to the current one and keep on doing so for every observation. For example, if you look at the table on the left, so here my variable changes from number of credit cards to and the number of credit cards up to. So initially, if you look at this slide, my variable was number of credit cards. Now here I have a variable number of credit cards up to. So guys, it's very important to understand. I'm giving you particular examples so that you don't just see numbers. You understand what the data is talking about. And this is very basic when you're actually working into credit risk analytics or any analytics profile. So number of customers holding credit card up to 1. Okay, up to 1 is either 0, not 0, only 1 credit card. So this is 150. If you go back here, the value initially is same. So number of credit card 1 is equal to 150. Okay. Now here number of credit cards is equal to 2, and for against that number of customers is 300. Okay. Now you want to check the people who are holding number of credit cards up to 2. So that will include people holding 1 credit card and people holding 2 credit cards. So you will add that. So I'll go back to this graph again. So you will add back this 150 and 300 and total will become 450. Now if I ask you the number of credit cards up to 3. Here, right? So you will add these three values. So you will add 150 plus 300 plus 450. That would become 900. So here your value becomes 900. Now you keep on adding and finally your total becomes 3000. So you have 3000 customers in your data and they hold credit cards up to 10. So a lot of times this distribution has an actual business importance and senior leadership wants to show. They just want to show how my portfolio is developing. Now this is again a simple example of cumulative frequency distribution, how to prepare it in MS Excel. So you will be getting the material and then you can follow it from here. Another example is stem leaf diagram. Although this technique is hardly used anywhere right now, and I'll tell you my experience is now, I've been working more than 10 years now, I have never used it, but this technique is quite archaic and a lot of people used to use it, but not mostly right now used in when you talk about research where the data size is small, you don't have one second. One second. Okay, can you see my screen now? Yeah, why is just hold on. Hi guys, I'm back. So I hope all of you can see my screen. If not, just looping me. Okay, we were talking about the stem leaf diagram. So it is hardly used right now. So it is pretty simple. If you look about, if you look at the data on the left side, so if you see the serial number is from 1 to 20, and against that you have the age populated, right? So it is not sorted right now. In the right most right column, the age is sorted. So if you see, for in 20s, the age is 21, 23, 24, and 27. So what you do is, when I say 20s, so this 20 becomes the stem, and the value and the number against that, like 1 is actually 21, 3 is actually 23, 4 is 24, 7 is 27. So basically 20 stem plus leaf. So 20 plus 1 is equal to 21. So you have the value 21, 23, 24, and 27. Similarly, in the stem 30, you have 1, 3, 4, 5, 6, 9 populated. So 31, 33, 34, 35, 36, 39. Similarly for 40 stem and 50 stem. Now line plots. Line plot diagrams may not be suitable for large data. They are not much extensively used, but while you are doing modeling, while you are studying data, these line plots or scatter plots are used. You check how my data is distributed. You check what is the density of my data. So if you see a lot of crosses around a particular value on an experiment, you say my data is more condensed into this part, and it is more focused into this area. So a lot of my observation lie into this particular X variable. So what has happened here is, on your X axis, it is the score of the customer. Okay. So say it's like, it's in the range of 20, 25, 30, 35, 40, 45, 50. That is your X axis. And how many customers are having a score of 20? So three customers are having a score of 20. Five are having a score of 30, so you have five crosses against that. Okay. So usually what happens is, when you actually look into the data, our FICO, if FICO starts usually from less than 660, then it goes from 660 up till 720 or 740. So you will see most of your customers will be into the bucket like 660 to 720. So like 60% of the population or 70% of the population will be having a score between 660 to 700 or 720. So if you put that into x-axis and you see that instead of 30 you have 660 here, then 35 you have 680, then you have 700 here. So mostly these processes will be lying in this area, and this area will become very condensed with these values, and other values will be scattered around across the x-axis. Okay, so this was more about summarizing data. When you get the data, how you visualize it or how you put it into a visual form, so that by looking at the graph, by looking at the table, by doing something, you actually understand how my data is looking like right now. What is the distribution, how it is distributed across values. Now let's get a bit more statistical in nature. So we will be touching the first part of our statistics here, which is called measure of central tendency. So measure of central tendency is mostly defined by its name, the central tendency, the value which is more tended towards center. What is the value? What is that particular value? So you check a central value of a data. There are different parts of measures of central tendency. What is mean, what is median, what is mode. So guys, I just want to ask, which one of you is not familiar with mean, median and mode? Hi, are you all with me? Asif is familiar. No, Asif, I will not skip. I will cover it. What about Vishal, Rahul?
Hi, Tarun, I am familiar with this.
Okay. Great, it's good to know that you guys are familiar, so we will be covering this quickly. And not much to explain here to you guys. So first of measure of central tendency is mean. It is called arithmetic mean as well. When you have a data, a simple way to define a mean is, if you have value from x1 to xn, you do a summation of all these values and divide it by number of observations. So x1 plus x2 till xn divided by n, and it is also denoted by x bar. This is your mean. When you have frequency values populated against it, for example, if you see in the right table below, the number of impact is 1, the number of customers is 150. You have to calculate the mean here. You will do x1 into f1 plus x2 into f2 and so on and so forth, and divide by f1 plus f2 plus f1, all the frequencies. In the Excel, you can do it by using a sum product function. So in the numerator, you will do a sum product of two columns, which is your number of credit cards and number of customers, and divided by sum of number of customers, which is a frequency. Then you get average number of credit cards a person holds. Median is actually the actual mid value, which divides the data into 50-50 ratio. So on the left side of the median you have 50% of the data, right side you have the 50% of the data, but in an ordered category. And the biggest problem with the median is it is affected by the extreme observations. So for example, if you have a data, say like where you have values 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and then you have the value 20, 30, 60, 80. Yes, every measure of central tendency is affected by outliers. That's why it becomes very important into our data when we are actually making the model to remove the outliers. Only median, yeah, arithmetic mean is affected, but when you talk about the median, as I said, it divides the data into 50-50%. So its values remain same. So for example, if you have a data 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and then you have observation like 60, 70, 80, 90, right? So here your median would be 5. But if you talk about mean, your mean would be somewhere in the range of 30 or 40. So that would be affected by extreme observation. So median is mostly used when you have to resist the effect of extreme observation. Third measure of central tendency is mode. Mode is basically, if you remember our example, so mode is the highest number of observations which are existing in a particular data for a variable. So if you talk about number of credit cards, where the number of credit cards is 4, the number of customers is highest, which is 660. So that becomes my mode. So your client or your analytic boss can come and ask, hey Santosh, I want to check which of the customers are how many customers are there which are having the maximum number of credit cards in my portfolio. So what he is actually asking is, Rinmoy, tell me the mode of my data in terms of number of cards. So here you will say, I have 660 customers who are holding 4 credit cards, which is highest if I talk about the distribution of number of credit cards from 1 to 10. So hence, out of my total population of say 3000, I have 660 customers, or around 20% of the customers who are holding number of credit cards equal to 4. That is my mode of the data in statistical terms. Okay. So next is a measure of spread. So spread is more about how my data is spread across. Okay. So usually you check the central tendency of the data, where my data is centrally located. In the spread, you check how my data is spread around that central value. Okay. In a particular scenario, you want to check that where most of my data is concentrated. So that is my checking. That is where I'm trying to check the central tendency. And if I'm trying to check how much of my data is spread as farther from that central value, that is a measure of spread. Okay. Now there are different measures of spread. One is a variance of standard deviation, linear range, or interquartile range. Now, interquartile range can be interdecile range as well or anything. It depends what do you want to do with your data and how do you want to show it. Now, whenever you will be working into analytics, whether your client or your boss is asking you to build a particular strategy, or they want to build a particular MIS, or they want to build models, or they want to check the data, basically any data warehouse, that the variance of standard deviation come into play. In that way, it becomes the mostly common used measure of strength. And it essentially tells you how far an average or observation are from the mean or from your central value. So, for an individual set of data like x1 to xn, my simple formula of variance is summation of xi minus x bar by 2 divided by n. Xi minus x bar square divided by 10. Where xi is my individual value for x variable and x bar is the mean. And that is how I calculate my variance. If I have a frequency populated against each of the variables, so I will add that frequency part, I will xi minus x bar square, I will multiply it by frequency as well, and similarly divide it by 10 square. Yes, this variance is for the whole population. So you want to check it at overall level, how much variation is there in my data when I compare it to my central value. Okay. And when you talk about standard deviation, it is actually the square root of variance. That is how we calculate the standard deviation. So guys, if you talk about the variance or deviation, it is actually just want to check how my data is deviating from a central value. How much my data is varying from my central value. So both terms are kind of similar in nature. You just want to study your data, you want to check your data so that you can make statistical conclusions out of your data, and you get to understand that how will you use this data into building further equations. So these are all initial steps which are very much required while you are building a model. So model is not just running a prop logistic. Prop logistic is a very simple statement. You just have to define the variables and just run prop logistic by equal to x1 and x2 whatever. But what x variables to put into? Whether you think those x variables are important or not, that thing is very important to know. If you don't know your variables, you don't know your data, your model will not become robust. I will tell you my personal example. Mostly we use standard deviation. So as I said, these are the similar. So if you square standard deviation, you will come at variance. If you square root variance as a positive value, you will come at standard deviation. Okay. So I was giving a particular example. Like I was working for Sita DeepFast model, and for building one particular PD model, we used to take around 1.5 months, I would say, for example. And in that 1.5 months, the variable selection, how do we select the variables? How do we define the variables? How do we modify and try to use those variables? That was the most important part. And more than 50% of time used to get spent on variable selection. Variable selection is the most important one. Usually what happens is when people try to learn modeling, or they hear from someone about statistical modeling, they just think why variables and x variables, and you just have to run the equation and you are there. No. A modeling is much more deeper and needs to be done at a much more granular level. Because if anyone can run a simple prop logistic, you have a data, you decide a y variable, you have multiple x variables, you just run a logistic and you get the data and you get a model. You present it to your client, hey, I have prepared the model. No, that is not the case. Each variable goes through strict scrutiny. Why you have included that variable? Why you think that variable is important for this model? Why you think this variable is not important for this model? If you think the variable in its current form is not directly usable for the model, how you will transform that variable? If you're having two or three variables in your data which are giving similar kind of information, which variable you want to use and why? These kind of questions are very, very important at the first stage of the model. If you do your variable selection, if you build your data understanding very thoroughly and very properly, your model will come out as very good. And after that, model building is not the end of it. When you build the model, there are a lot of validations which you have to do on your model. And those validations should pass on to each and every variable on your equation and on your every factor which you have calculated. And the value of every factor will be dependent on what kind of variables which you have used. I'll give you a very brief example. So, in my previous organization, there was an analyst. She was trying to build a behavioral model. Okay. So, we were checking about how many customers are going to lapse or attrite out of my portfolio in the next 1 year. So, what happened was, she when she was doing some calculations, and the engineer was trying to run some variable selection. So she was not finding good variables which are holding ground for building the model. Okay, so what she did was, for every variable, for most of the variables, she built indicator variables. Like for example, when you use categorical variables like male or female, you create an indicator against it. So if it's male, then 1, else 0. So you transform your data like this when you're handling categorical variables. So what was happening was, she built a model, she brought that model to me, and what I saw was, out of 7 or 8 variables, there were 5 or 6 indicator variables. Now, first problem. She did not understand the variables properly. What information those variables were given? What variables should have been taken into her model? And they may not be giving you good results at the beginning, but by some tweaking or transformation of those variables, those would become actually very good predictor variables. So then she came to me and told me, sir, I have prepared a model, it's giving very good results, my p values are all good, my p value is so good, my r square is also good of the model, but that model was not making any sense. So it's very important to understand the variables and study those variables properly. When you are building a model, don't just hop on to run a prop logistic or prop regression. Understand the data first, build it first, clean it first. Think about what each variable means, what value it can provide to your model. We are not here as a mechanic that we are just given few parts, we will fit into it and machine will run. No, it's not a machine. It is a model. Don't confuse it with the machine learning. So it's not mechanical in nature. You are a statistician, you are an analyst, you are building econometric models. You should know each and everything what you are actually putting into your model. It's like a very crude example, comparison I would do with building a medicine. You do lot of experiments, what amount of different chemicals you want to put into a particular medicine. Sometimes you put 1 milligram, sometimes you put 10 milligram, sometimes you mix it with other chemicals. And then finally you conclude that, hey, I'm going to use these 6 or 7 chemicals. And I will mix 1 or 2 chemical and prepare a new compound out of it. And then finally, doing all this, I will make a medicine, which will be actually helpful and can be used further as well. It's not a one-time process. So whenever you make a model, if you talk about risk model, they go on in place at least for 2 or 3 years. Companies do not spend time and energy on rebuilding the models again and again. So it's very important to make your models robust. If you talk about marketing models, they have a life of around 1 to 2 years. Because of changing business scenario, changing business needs, changing products, the marketing models may change. But risk model, or particularly credit risk model, goes on for a long. I'll give you an example. Like, I was working for CCAR models, and the models which we were working upon, we built them in 2013, and we were submitting them again and again every year to Federal Bank by doing some tweakings in the model or changing the variables. And for each and every variable, we have to particularly document.